I'm very, very, very glad to be here. It's really a nice thing to have conferences organized again. And so it's really a great pleasure to be here. And it's also nice that many people from further can attend this conference. I'm enjoying it a lot. So the topic of my talk today is group actions on LP spaces, and especially I will be interested in how the behavior of group actions on LP spaces depend mainly on the value of P, and also how they depend on the geometry of the group. But this is I will mainly focus on fixing a group and make P vary and seeing what kind of phenomenon we can see. So this is a joint work with my colleague in Lyon, Amin Marakchi. Well, there is a preprint on the archive that I will be following. Okay, so the plan was the following. So I will first talk fast about group actions on LP spaces in full generality, and then I will focus on the specific case of LP spaces where actually the although the questions are the same, the tools are very, very much different. If we are interested in arbitrary Banach spaces, it quickly becomes a question on the geometry of Banach spaces. So it's a question that I enjoy a lot. But that's not today's talk. LP spaces, it involves questions in more ergodic theory or group actions on measure spaces and this kind of objects that are more related to the topic of the conference. And then I will state a theorem, and we will see that there are some critical parameters that arise in the statement of the theorem. So I will try to, if time permits, discuss how, in which situations we can compute these critical parameters. And the typical situations are lattices in semi-simple algebraic groups. Or Orly groups. Okay, so first, the setting. So G will be a finitely generated countable group. So most of the results can be generalized to locally compact groups and not necessarily compactly generated, but just to have nice statements, I will just stick on that. And the objects I'm studying are actions by isometries. I could have said on norm spaces, but actually, if I have an action by isometries on a norm space, I get, by completion, an action by isometries on the completion, which is the Banach space. So it's as nice to restrict to Banach spaces. And there is the very basic and old theorem by Mazur and Ulam, which says that isometries, in the sense of surjective isometries of a norm space, they are necessarily affine. So if you have Hilbert space, this is an extremely easy exercise, but if you are strictly convex, it's a rather easy exercise. And for general space, it's also true. It's a theorem of Mazur and Ulam. And so a group theoretical way of expressing this statement is saying that the isometric group of a Banach space E decomposes as a semi-direct product of the orthogonal group, so the group of linear isometry, the linear meaning fixing the origin, and then the translation parts. So yet another way to state that is that if you have an action of the group G by isometries on your Banach space, it decomposes as the formula here. So the action is, there is the translation part, which is a representation by linear isometries of G on E, so this is pi. And then the translation part is what's called the cocycle, because the fact that G is an action, meaning that GH, if you act it on x, is the same as making first h act and then g act, this translates to the cocycle property. And this is very nice, because if you see the cocycle property is a linear property. So actually, the geometric question of studying actions by isometries on Banach spaces, this can be turned into a functional analysis question, because we have a vector space of cocycles, and we are studying actually more than a vector space, it's a Banach space of cocycles. So we can use tools from functional analysis to study the objects which are geometric in nature. And as was already discussed earlier in the conference. So having a fixed point for a global fixed point for the action of the group on the Banach space, this is the same as saying that the cocycle can be written in a very specific form. The V of G is xi minus pi of G xi. And such a cocycle of this form is called the cobound. And again, the cobounders, they form a subspace of the cocycles. And so we have a nice vector space, which is the quotient space of the space of cocycles, the space of cobounders, that is the first cohomology group. So the vocabulary of cohomology this is the vocabulary. I will not use anything about cohomology, but it's nice to encode the questions that I'm studying in terms of the behavior of this vector space. And that's what I will study. So the most classical example of a Banach space is the Hilbert spaces. And in this case, this is one of the central objects in geometric group theory, which are Cagedan's property T, which can be expressed by theorems of Delorme and Guichardet by saying that every action by isometries on a Hilbert space has a fixed point. And then there is a strong negation of Cagedan's property T, which is the celebrated Haguerus property, or Gromov's AT minability, which is the strong opposite, meaning that not only G has an action that without a fixed point, but actually it's a proper action, meaning that the orbit map goes in norm to infinity. The distance between a point and its value, its image by G tends to infinity when G goes to infinity in the group. And this is certainly the most important case of study, but there are some reasons to go beyond Hilbert spaces. And for example, you know, I think it's good when you are in a geometric group theory conference to explain that the questions you're studying are asked by Gromov. So this question also has been asked by Gromov. He has asked in his very celebrated paper on asymptotic invariance of groups that can you understand, given a group when they admit, discrete here means proper, and unbounded means without fixed point, isometric action on some LP space or another space of comparable degree of convexity. And just to explain why Gromov put this assumption of degree of convexity in the picture, because there are very simple examples. If you do not put any strong convexity assumption on the space, you can construct wild actions. And so we just want to get rid of this stupid examples and see what remains. So the stupid example is if you work on L infinity space, then if you take any proper Lipschitz function on your group, then this gives rise to the action by translation gives rise to an affine action on the coset space of F plus L infinity of G, and you can state another way that saying that you get just by declaring that F is zero, you get a proper action by affine isometries on an infinity space. And in the same way, it's not the same way, but on L1, so on L1 you cannot construct such thing, but you can construct such thing on the space, on the subspace of L1 made of functions with mean zero. But as an affine span, it's the same as the space of functions with mean one. So you consider the action of G on the functions with mean one, and this is an affine action on an affine subspace of L1, and it does not have a fixed point unless the group is infinite, because a fixed point would be a function that is constant and which has total mass one, so this cannot happen for an infinite group. And so, what goes wrong with this example, that's the philosophy behind Gromov's question, is that they are not very convex, they are not uniformly convex, and the suggestion behind Gromov's question is that maybe if you put more convexity assumptions, maybe this kind of example cannot occur. And this is still, despite a lot of efforts by many people, in particular Bader, Femen, Gelander, Monod, and Laforgue, and me, and Tim Delat, and many other people, this is still wide open, I would say. And in particular, there is this very intriguing conjecture that if you take SLNZ in the T range, the higher rank range, then it has the fixed point property whenever it acts by isometries on a uniformly convex Banach space. So Fe, I probably forgot to define it. It means that whenever you act by isometries on E, you have a fixed point. Or in other way, the cohomology of the group with values in every orthogonal representation on uniformly convex space vanishes in the vocabulary, cohomological vocabulary. And this is open, but if you restrict to LP spaces, this is a theorem. I will discuss that. It's a theorem by these four people, Baderfield, Gazzotta, and Monod. And actually, more is known. There are lots of things that are understood for LP spaces that are not understood for general Banach spaces. So just this is a slide that I will go fast with, so just to fix the notation and the terminology. So I will denote LP to denote the LP space of a standard measure space. So you can choose your standard measure space you prefer. They will all be the same spaces. And I will consider two groups associated to the measure space X mu. One will be the automorphism of X with mu with brackets like this, meaning that it's the group of measure class preserving transformations of X. So it's measurable bijections from X into X, so that the inverse is also measurable. And the push forward of the measure mu is absolutely continuous, actually is equivalent to, by T is equivalent to mu. And you have the subgroup, which is the subgroup of the transformation which preserves the measure, so that the push forward R equal to mu. And well, here I'm anticipating a bit, so there will be a theorem, and there will be a proof of the theorem, and the crux in the proof of the theorem will involve this kind of analytic objects, which are the weak LP spaces. So I take the opportunity now to discuss them. So weak LP spaces, they are spaces that are small variants of LP spaces, say. So these are the space of functions or measurable functions such that they satisfy the same Markov inequality as the functions in LP. So meaning that the measure of the points such that the value of f is greater than t is bounded above by a constant divided by t to the p. So the first example is that if you have a function in LP, then you have this inequality with c with the pth power of the LP norm of f. But there are other functions, for example, a function f of lambda, which is lambda to the minus 1 over p on the positive real numbers with the Lebesgue measure. This is, does not belong to any LQ space, but it's quite nice because it's in weak LP spaces. And as I said, so the crux of the proof that will come probably in half an hour will be that if you take a function that is in a weak LP space and that is also bounded, then actually it has good integrability properties. It is LQ for every q greater than p. But this is, well, we will see the relevance of that much later. So for a moment, you can forget about these weak LP spaces and just remember that the notations that are important right now are the LP and these two automorphism groups. Okay, and so here, now this is a slide that gives a very brief and biased summary of a small part of the thing that has been known for a long time for actions on LP spaces. So first, I repeat the definition. FLP means the fixed point for every action by isometries on an LP space has a fixed point or bounded orbit. and then the strong, the analog of the Hagerup property is the ALP minability, meaning that there exists a proper action by isometries on an LP space. And about these two notions, there are lots of things that have been discovered in the last several decades. So I will start with one example that has played an important role is the computation by Pansu in the late 80s of the LP cohomology of hyperbolic spaces. So I will restrict to quaternionic hyperbolic spaces because they are more relevant for applications, but Pansu did not restrict to this. So in particular, what Pansu proves is that if you take actually SPN1, so the isometric group of the quaternionic hyperbolic space of dimension n, then it does not have FLP for p greater than 4n plus 2. Actually, he computes the cohomology with values in the left regular representation of SPN1, and he says that this vanishes if and only if p is less than or equal to 4n plus 2. And in particular, you get unbounded action on some LP spaces, which are just LP of the group itself. And actually, there is a, in 2007, Cordier, Tessera, and Vallette, they observed that actually they are more than having no fixed point. The actions that the Pensu constructs, they are proper actions, or at least you can get proper actions. And this theorem of Pensu that I actually on the slide I stated for co-compact lattices, which are examples of hyperbolic groups, actually it was generalized, vastly generalized by William Yu. And they are, well, here I'm being very partial because the history of this result of Yu is wide also. There are many other people who have worked on that, but the conclusion of Yu is something very neat. So if you have any Gromov hyperbolic group, then there is a value that is large, that depends on the group G, such that you have a proper action on LP spaces for all P greater than this value. And something that you can also compare to Pensu's result is the solution of Bader-Friedman, Gelder, Monod to their conjecture in the case of LP spaces. So in higher rank, you cannot have proper action on LP spaces. And also, they have been studied about how this FLP behave with respect to propensity, and I'm summarizing small portions of this result. So it's known that if for some P you have the FLP, then you have propensity. And if P is less than 2, so there is something very specific going on here. So if P less than 2, the converse is true. So if you have propensity, you have FLP for all P less than 2. Not only P equals to 2, which is the Long-Wichardet theorem, but also for P less than 2. And in the same way, if you have a proper action on Hilbert space, you can construct out of it a proper action on LP space for any P. This is Cornulet and Serra-Vallette. And something that I like a lot, it's a recent result by, Drutu and McKay, which proved that if you take a random group in the correct random group model à la Gromov, actually the probability that you have FLP for some P goes to 1 when the parameters in the random model goes to infinity. So if you know a bit more, you know that in some of these models which are considered here, the group are hyperbolic. So you know from Yu's result that you have proper action for P large depending on the group. But actually what it says is that the smallest value, the P of G, when G is a random group, it has to go to infinity with the parameters. That's what Drutu and McKay proved. Okay, so this is just a list of results. And actually, if you look at the results, the very clear impression that you get from this result is that it's easier to act on an LP space for P large than for P small. Because in all the examples, that's the result that they proved. They prove for P large, you get proper action, but for P small, no. But this, from this observation, it's rather natural to expect that this is not just a list of results that have this feature. There should be something deeper behind, and this was indeed asked by Chatterjee, Drutu, and Haglund, and it's often referred to as Drutu's conjecture. So it is that if you fix the group G, you can consider the set of values of P such that the group has FLP, and the opposite, the set of values of P such that the group has a proper action in LP space. And the natural question that is based on the evidences of the previous slide is that these sets are intervals. So if the group is infinite, they are clearly disjoint, but the conjecture was that they are intervals. And well, we will see that this is indeed correct, but first I just want to state results that have been obtained before and independently by, for example, Baxuron and Homer Lavi and Baptiste Olivier, which is that if you consider only small LP spaces, then the conjecture is true. If you consider action by PMP action, so if you assume that the measure space X mu is a probability measure and the action, you have an action of G on this probability measure space which preserves the measure, then you can build out of this an action in LP space. And under some assumptions, Lavi and Olivier, and then under weaker assumptions, Kalandar and Xuron, they prove that the LP cohomology of the actions coming here, they all vanish, so in particular they are intervals, and we removed all the technical conditions with Amin. So I'm just explaining a very basic lemma that is from which the partial answer here follows immediately, and which is of independent interest, I believe. So this is something that is not surprising, but to our knowledge, it has not been observed before. So if you put standard assumption on a group, compactly generated and a reasonable probability measure, so for example, the uniform probability measure on a compact neighborhood of the identity, and if you take an orthogonal representation on a uniformly convex Banach space, and if you assume that the representation has spectral gap, meaning that the representation that you get on the quotient of the space by the space of invariant vectors that does not have almost invariant vectors, then the conclusion is that every co-cycle has you can add to it a co-boundary to turn it into a harmonic representant. Okay, and from this maybe I can draw just something very very basic. So if you have two such if you have E1 and P1, which P1 is a representation on the Banach space E1 and E2 is a representation on the Banach space E2, which both have spectral gap and if you have two such things like this, so that they both have spectral gap, and if you have an injection from the Banach space E1 to the Banach space E2, which is a G equivariant, then the lemma implies that you have an injection of the cohomology group, cohomology spaces. Because if you have an element here, you can take a harmonic representant, then the image would be a harmonic representant here, but the harmonic representant is zero, cannot be zero unless it is zero, and since the map here is injective, you get that. Actually, in this situation that arises quite often, you get injection of cohomology groups. So in particular, if you know that the second cohomology group is zero, then you get for free that the first cohomology group is zero. And if you apply it to LP and LQ in the situations where Hölder's inequality tells you that you have the injections that we are discussing, then you get the statements that are here. So you get something that I will come back to this later, but you get something that is particularly interesting and that is related to questions that are still open about our children on actions as LP spaces. So we'll come back to this later. And for those also who are more into operator algebras, you can see that the argument that I just gave, it applies equally to non-intuitive LP spaces too. So if you do not start from a measure space, but a fundamental algebra, you get the same, Hölder's inequality behaves the same way and you get similar results. Okay, but this partial answer is something that is only restricted to specific kind of actions on LP spaces, so it's far from answering the question. So the next slide is I'm just saying that yes, the answer is correct. So I will state a theorem saying that these are intervals, and actually we know that the first interval, the first set is known to be opened by an argument of Fischer and Margulis. Once we know that it is an interval, we know that it's an interval of the form zero up to some critical parameter that I will denote by PC of G, and PC of G not belonging to the set. And for the second interval, we know that it's an interval, but we don't know whether the endpoint belongs to it or not. So in particular, the theorem, the conclusion is that to any group, you can associate a pair of critical parameters that encode the behavior of actions on LP space. And I think, I'm convinced that it's a very interesting project to try to understand the behavior of this critical parameters under the groups. And also, we'll probably see a bit, but it's probably very interesting to understand what happens at the critical parameters. There are we will see from the proof that there are some behaviors that come out of the proof which perhaps indicate that there is something interesting going on behind that.
Are there
Yes, you can do something stupid by if you take two groups for which you know exactly what is the PC for for both, and if they are equal, and for the product the PC of the product will be the minimum, and the PC of the P prime C of the product will be the maximum. So. But actually, there are more things to say. This is a good question, so I gave a rapid answer, but there are more intelligent things to say about this question. Okay, so the theorem we have with Amin, the main theorem is something that is much more precise than just saying that the set is an interval. It's something it's a statement that is quite clear. So it says that if you have any action by isometries on an LP space, and any Q strictly greater than P, then you can construct another action by affine isometry on another LQ space, so that actually the norm of the orbit to the power P is exactly equal to the norm of the orbit for the second action to the power Q. And so from that you get all the results, because if you know that the orbit alpha G of zero is not bounded, then you get that the norm of beta g of zero is not bounded. So you get the first set is an interval, and if you know that that this is proper, you get that the other is proper, and so it's clear that this theorem is more precise than what I claimed from the previous slide. Okay, so a few remarks that perhaps illustrate what I wanted to say earlier in a vague way. It is that the action beta that you construct, actually it's not an arbitrary action on LP space. It comes from an action of G on a measure space which preserves an infinite measure. So we know from the discussion just before that it cannot, if you take a group with property T, the discussion that I just said is that if you take an action on a measure space which preserves a probability measure, all the cohomology groups with respect to for every all p, they all vanish. So you cannot, if you have a group that has property t but that has unbounded action on some LP spaces, you will never be able to achieve the conclusion of the theorem with a measure preserving action. A finite measure preserving action, but actually you can with an action which preserves an infinite measure. Just for a second, I want to also talk about non-discrete groups. So this is true for non-discrete groups, and actually you can apply it to the whole isometric group of the LP space. And you get two consequences. One, you get that if you take the LP space with the norm to the power p, you can realize it isometrically as a subset of LQ with the norm to the power q. So actually, in this setting, it was already a theorem by Mendel and Naor, but we get a different proof. And also, what we get is that this embedding, in a sense, has some kind of equivariance behind. So that is perhaps not the obvious one, but there is some equivariance behind that. And what you get at the same time is that if you're interested in big groups, I know that some people here are, you get that the isometric group of the LP space, you can embed it as a closed subgroup of the isometric group of the LQ space whenever P is strictly less than Q. And a good question is whether can you show that the converse can ever happen? Can you show that if you have a continuous group homomorphism for the group of LQ to the isometric group of LP, such a thing can only be kind of trivial? So this is something that we do not know how to do. Okay, and my goal now, I think I have 15 minutes. Is that correct? So I will spend some time to explain the proof of the theorem, because this is a theorem that is very easy to prove. There are some ideas that are easy to explain, and I'm convinced that I should be able, if I if I do not mess things up too much, to explain you the full proof of the theorem. So it's not a complicated and very involved theorem. And if time permits, I will discuss a bit the question that interests me most and that is still partly open, which will be to compute these critical parameters for particularly interesting groups. Okay. So about the proof. So recall. So now let's look. Let's have a last look at the statement of the theorem. So we start with an action of biisometries of a group on an LP space, and you want to construct an action on a group on an LQ space. So the first ingredient in the proof is something very old from the beginning of Banach space theory. It's a theorem of Banach, which was and also completed by Lamperti, which says that if P is not 2, and actually the linear isometries of an LP space, they are the only one that you can think of. So of course, when you have a measure preserving automorphism of the space, you get by precomposition an isometry of LP. Actually, if you think a bit more, if you only preserve the measure class, precomposing by this measure class preserving transformation does not give you rise to an isometry of an LP space, but if you correct by the correct the power of the Radon-Degutin derivative, this becomes just by the definition of the Radon-Degutin derivative, this becomes an isometry. And also, when you have a function, you can multiply it by a measurable function which takes the value plus and minus one, and of course, this does not change the norm of an LP space, of a function in the LP space. And so, what this discussion says is that inside the orthogonal group of the LP space, you have the semi-direct product of the outermost, the out of X with of the measure class of mu, and the space of measurable functions with values in plus minus one. And the theorem of Banach and Lamperti says that there are no other isometry of LP space. And so this is why studying isometries of LP spaces or action of isometries by LP spaces rapidly becomes a question more in ergodic theory rather than geometry of Banach spaces. And I want to insist that you can see two very obvious consequences of this, but I think it's very easy to get things mixed up, so I'm just insisting that you have two different consequences. So if you have a representation pi p of G or by linear isometries on an LP space, then the formula that I write makes perfect sense for any measurable function. So you can extend it uniquely to a continuous action continuous invertible transformation on the topological vector space of measurable functions by the same formula. And in another direction, if you replace P by Q in this formula, you see that any representation pi P gives rise to a different, no, it's not the same formula, P is replaced by Q, but you gives rise to a representation on an LQ space. And it's usually, people have mainly been interested in when you make P vary, you take pi P and you take pi Q and see what happens. And today we will work more than with the thing that seems less natural, because we will work with the same formula, which for P different from Q does not give rise to any continuity on LQ. But that's what I want to say. And the observation, so here, if you keep this slide, you should remember that I forgot an assumption here. The observation that I make is that if for a property T group, I do not know any unbounded action on LP space such that the cocycle is not a formal co-boundary, meaning that what is a formal co-boundary? You can take, as in the formula here, a function psi that is measurable, but no integrability property. And then you can always define psi minus pi p of g psi, because we said that the pi p of g makes sense for any measurable function. And so if by some chance you can show that b of g, which is a priori only measurable, is in LP, then you have constructed a cocycle in values in LP, and which most of the time will not be a co-boundary, because because essentially in many situations there is only at most one measurable function such that this happens, and so you, if the function was not in LP, then it's not a coboundary. For groups that are not LP spaces, actually we can show that there are co-cycles that are not coboundaries, but for property T groups we did not manage to find examples. So I put here what is open is that for property T group are all boundaries, all co-cycles formal coboundaries. And actually, I believe that the answer to this question is no. But and it's a bit sad because otherwise the proof of the theorem will be very, very easy. Because it's very easy to show that if you do not restrict to all co-cycles but only to formal co-boundaries, what you expect is true. Meaning that if you take P less than Q, I forgot to write less than Q, then if you know that all formal co-boundaries are co-boundaries, so meaning that the formal cohomology group vanishes for Q, then you know by the theorem says that the same is true for P. So if you knew that all boundaries, all co-cycles were co-boundaries, this would be a theorem saying that if you fix any action or any group homomorphism from G to this semi-direct product of the automorphism group, the measurable functions with value plus minus one, then for any such fixed action, you would get that the set of values of P such that the cohomology group vanishes, this is an interval. And it's stronger than saying that the main theorem is saying that if you consider the set of all actions on all LPs, on LP spaces as a whole, then you're saying that for all of them something is trivial implies that for the other Q the same is true. But here it's something much stronger because it's for any representation this would be true. So probably this theorem is certainly completely useless because we expect that the answer to the previous question was negative. But maybe this explains the way we reached the theorem. So there is something, a general tool to make co-cycles into co-boundaries. This is something that operator algebraists know very well because this is something that is at the heart of the Tomita Takezaki theory and the main tool to work with type 3 Feynman algebras. And this is the concept of skew product action. I will restrict to the commutative case, meaning that we have a measure space. So if you have an action on a non-singular action on a measure space X mu, and you'd have any abelian group A, then you can consider a function from G to the measurable functions from X with value A, which satisfies this co-cycle property, the same co-cycle property as we had earlier for when the abelian group was a Banach space. But you can do this for an arbitrary Banach space. You can the starting data is a representation sigma and the co-cycle like this. And the outcome of the construction, which is something very formal and very elementary, is that you can construct a new action on the space which is X direct product A with the class of the product measure of the measure, the only measure we have on X and the only measure we have on on A, which is the hard measure in this situation.
Because you assume that A is a...
Yes, here I assume that A has a hard measure, so locally compact, yes. And the formula that I write gives rise to an actual action that encodes the original co-cycle, and by construction, the former co-cycle becomes a co-boundary. But the formula that is here is something, a co-boundary, but evaluated at xA, and actually it does not depend on A, and it is the original co-cycle we started with. So this is nice, but there is the sentence that I wrote, the skew product action turns the co-cycle into a co-boundary, but the main drawback is that the new co-cycle it does not have any integrability property if A was not compact, because it's a function that does not depend on A. So it does not have any. We lose if we, you know, we are in our head. We are working with LP integrable co-cycles, and here we lose everything. But we have to correct that later. But there is something quite nice, is that you can turn the co-cycle co-boundary, but you lose something that you lose all the integrability property that you started with. But that's not a big issue, we will see. I just want to give one example, because this is something that is very classical. So if you, it's the Maharam, a particular case of the skew product action that I just defined is the Maharam extension. If you start with if the group is the positive real numbers that denoted by multiplication, and the cocycle is the Radon-Nikodym cocycle for the action of G on X, then this is a cocycle exactly. Well, this is the chain rule for the Radon-Nikodym derivatives. And you see that the skew product action, it's an action of the group on the product X times R plus star, the strictly positive real numbers, and which preserves a canonical infinite measure, which is just the product measure of mu with the measure dt. Well, here dt is the usual Lebesgue measure, so it's not the R measure on R plus, it's the Lebesgue measure on R. So, but for this choice, you get an infinite measure. So this is the Maharam extension, which turns an arbitrary action into an action which preserves an infinite measure. So this is very well known, and the skew product action is just a generalization of that in a more general setting. And now I can give the proof. Sorry. Okay. So let me give the proof of the main theorem. So let me start. So you recall that I want to prove that given an action by isometries on an LP space, I want to construct a new action on an LQ space such that the cocycles behave the same way. So we know by Banach-Lamperti that the isometry, the linear part of the representation, it comes from a morphism from G to this semi-direct product of the automorphism group with the measurable functions LU plus minus one. To simplify the exposition, I will assume for the beginning that there is no plus minus function in the picture. It's very easy to get rid of that, but it's easier to explain it without that. So we start with sigma, which is a group homomorphism from G to the automorphism group of the measure space. And we start with a cocycle with alu in LP. And the first step is to consider the Maharam extension, so the skew product for the Radon-Nikodym cocycle. And if you look at, if you think a bit, you see that the formula that I wrote here, C of Gx lambda, which is lambda to the minus 1 over P B of Gx, putting here the lambda to the minus 1 over p is exactly the thing that takes into account that you had this 1 over p's power of the Radon-Nikodym derivative in the formula for pi p. So this becomes a cocycle for the skew product action. And we are not that bad as far as integrability properties are concerned, because what is quite nice here is that we did not put the R measure on R, but we put the restriction of the Lebesgue measure on R plus star. So this new cocycle, actually, it belongs to a weak LP space. So it's not that bad, because we had this discussion at the beginning about weak LP spaces. And then we have a cocycle with values in R. So we take again a skew product action. We want to untwist this new cocycle. And so we get a new space, which is just the direct product, as I said, with an infinite measure, and we know that the cocycle that is here is a co-boundary. But I said the problem is that the new cocycle here now on this infinite measure space, it has no integrability property. So we will cut it. We will not cut the cocycle, but we will cut the function h that appears, so that c appears as a co-boundary with respect to h. And we do not take h, the function h, which maps x a to a, but we take a new function f prime, which is the composition of h with some function which is a compactly supported and continuous on non-zero on R. And now, and you can consider the formal co-boundary with respect to that. And using that you are working with LP spaces and the small computation that I made at the beginning, that if you have a function that is at the same time bounded and weak LP, it's in LQ for any Q, you get that this new co-cycle is also in LQ for every Q. And better, actually, if you can compute everything, and you see that actually the Q's power to the power Q of the norm is proportional to the P's power of the original co-cycle to the power P. And that's the conclusion of the theorem. And you see that the measure space is actually why that we construct it. The action preserves an infinite measure by construction.
Sorry,
yes?
I don't understand how you get this equality. So it seems that it almost does not depend on this choice of phi, of the function phi.
No, it does not depend on phi.
Where does this happen, that this function phi disappears?
Actually, you get a double integral, and there is a small computation you make. If you want to compute this now, you are integrating over x tilde times r, and x tilde was x times r plus. So you have a triple integral, and you can exchange the integral, and you see that actually you make a change of variable, which tells you that at the end you just get the L depends on phi, but the rest is that's how you get that. Yes, I think what I meant is that phi should be I wanted to put C infinity. Phi should be C infinity. Actually, Lipschitz is important. Thank you, Amin. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's the end of the proof. I think it's also the end of the talk. So I will I will stop. I was thinking that maybe I could at least show the slide, but no, I will stop here now. I can show. So here's the slide. So the slide is that for semi-simple groups, if you take any semi-simple Lie algebra, the critical parameter for the group and the lattices, they do not depend on the group nor the lattice, only on the Lie algebra, and we can compute that. Almost, except we cannot compute it for SPN1. That's our main frustration so far. And the ingredient is the thing that Romain wanted me to talk about, and I have no time, is that this critical parameter, it behaves very well with respect to LP measure equivalence. And the proof is essentially the same kind of induction that Romain explained in his proof today. And another ingredient is that if you take lattices in rank one groups, you have good estimates on what are the LP for which P they are all LP measure equivalents. Okay. So I am already over time, so I will stop with that, and thank you for your attention.